Welcome back. This would be our second class for the cultural institutions and the part of Indian heritage and culture, which is an important part for the GS paper 1 for your mains. Now, this would be our second class where we would be covering the education, the cultural institutions. As we said in the last class, most of the material that comes up for culture and art has 9 to 10 major institutes. We have tried to cover more than 40 to 50 cultural institutions, classifying them into different heads. So for today, we would be covering the cultural academies, museums and libraries. Now there are three basic cultural academy: the Lalit Kala Academy, the Sangeet Natya Academy and the Sahitya Academy. All these three are based in Ravindra Bhavan, which was created in 1961, and all these three are housed there. Besides these three academy, you have another important academy, which is National School of Drama. So let's start with the first academy. Now there are two options: either you can take down the notes as we go on, or all the this material, all the handouts would be available at doorsteptutor.com, the GS mains paper section 1. So you can go there and take the notes. So the first one that we would be discussing today is Lalit Kala Academy. Now this has been established in 1954. It's the India's National Academy for Fine Arts, funded by the Ministry of Culture. As you would see, most of the institutions here are being funded by Ministry of Culture, in contrast to the last class where we talked about the film division, which is mainly under the aegis of Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. So that's a kind of basic difference, and it's very, very important for your mains which department or which institution comes under which ministry. So you have the headquarters at New Delhi. It has five regional offices: Chennai, Kolkata, Shimla, Lucknow and Bhubaneswar in Odisha. Some of the major exhibitions include National Exhibition of Art and International Triennial India, which are part of Lalit Kala Academy. Now, this was in lieu with the dream of Pandit Nehru, who laid the kind of idea for a kind of cultural identity for India, or a kind of national identity. It organizes various scholarships and fellowship programs. It publishes a bilingual journal. Bilingual journal means a journal that is published in two languages, and it aims to promote the visual art. Now, some of the major objectives include organizing various activities, providing scholarships, fellowships, developing the various related regional associations, regional art centers, encouraging more exchange of ideas, kind of relationship between the national and the international organizations based on the fine arts and visual arts, promoting the publications of literature on art, and the various research studies related to the field. So it creates a kind of reserve fund or a sinking fund, and this fund would help or would be used for any kind of depreciation work or repairs or maintenance that is being required. The next is Sahitya Kala Academy. As the name suggests, in Hindi, Sahitya, the English translation would be literature. So this organization focuses on the literary works. As we said, all the three academies are housed at Rabindra Bhavan, New Delhi. The Sahitya Kala Academy has the regional offices at Calcutta, Bangalore, Chennai and Mumbai. Agartala in Tripura has the Northeast Center for Oral Literature. This organization was established in 54 by Government of India, shifted to Rabindra Bhavan in 61. It's the India's National Academy for Letters. So for your prelims examination, sometimes there is a direct question that is being put up: which of the following institutions is a National Academy of Letters? So you have the Sahitya Kala Academy. Then it promotes and preserves the literature in 24 languages. Besides the languages mentioned in the constitution, you have English and Rajasthani, which are part of the Sahitya Kala Academy. So the library is a kind of multilingual library where you have literature from various sources. Now some of the major fellowships provided under Sahitya Kala Academy: you have Premchand Fellowship for contributions in Hindi, Anand Kumar Swami Fellowship, that's mainly for ancient India, as he had done a lot of work in ancient India. You have Bhasha Samman for the contribution of ancient and medieval literature, Kavi Anuvadak program, where you have live performance where a person translates the work from the original language into another language. Yuva Puraskar to young writers below the age of 35 years is started from 2011. The next is Sangeet Natak Academy, known for music, drama and dance, established in 52, again set up under the government of India as a center for performing arts. So this is very important. This is a center of performing arts. Lalit Kala Academy was a center for fine arts. So that's again very, very important. Small things, but you must know. Then you have the Sangeet Natak Academy administers the National School of Drama, which was set up in 1959. It is collaborated with UNESCO to save the cultural heritage. Some of the institutions that come under this are the Manipur Dance Academy in Imphal, Satriya Center. Then you have Kathak Kendra in Delhi, Ravindra Rangshala, Chauk Center in Jamshedpur, Northeast Center and Center for Kuttiyattam in Trivandrapuram, which is a project to support the Sanskrit Theatre of Kerala. The idea is, as we said, this focuses on performing arts in contrast to Lalit Kala Academy, which focuses on fine arts. So you have researches on performing art, establishment of theatres, the literature on performing arts, promoting the folk dance and the music, and collaborating with international community. The next one, we said there were three academies. These are very, very important. The fourth important part of which considered as one of the academies is National School of Drama. It was established by Sangeet Natak Academy in 1959, as we saw previously. In 75, it became an autonomous institute and became a part of the culture, Department of Culture. It has two wings, the repertory company and the theatre and education company. So it became, it comes under the Societies Registration Act of 1860, fully financed by Ministry of Culture. You have some of the few main elements that are coming under it, that Sanskrit drama, the Western drama, the Asian drama and so on. And it has one regional resource cum research center, which is based in Bangalore. The next is the set of museums that we would be covering. So this is a kind of museum and library. So first we'll cover the museums and then we'll move on to the major libraries in India. So the first is Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, established in memory of Jawaharlal Nehru under the Ministry of Culture, located at Teen Murthy House, which is considered as the official residence of the first Prime Minister of India. It has four parts: the Memorial Museum, Library on Modern India, Center for Contemporary Studies and Nehru Planetarium. It's considered one of the best libraries in Delhi for the study of social sciences. The idea is to preserve the belongings of Jawaharlal Nehru, the personal items, the momentum, the personal papers, the books being published by Jawaharlal Nehru, and to promote students. So you have numerous fellowships and award programs, exhibitions that are being held, and various publications and seminars that are being organized. So you have the Jawaharlal Nehru Museum. The next important is Allahabad Museum, founded in 1931 by Ministry of Culture. It is important because it's the first museum to become self-reliant totally on solar energy. So fully self-reliant for power generation. Originally, the idea for this museum was given by William Moore in 1863. It has two galleries which are separately devoted to Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru. It includes more than 25,000 books, was declared an Institute of National Importance in 1985. It has numerous collections of Behrud, Bhumar and Jamsoot sculptures, which are very, very unique. And the next one that we would be discussing today is Bharat Bhavan. This has been developed by the Trust of Legislature of Madhya Pradesh. It's a kind of autonomous multi-arts complex established in 82. It has various sections. So you have an open-air amphitheater known as Bahirang, a fine arts workshop, a studio theater known as Abhirang, auditorium known as Antarang, the museum tribal and folk art, the libraries of Indian poetry and the classical folk museum. It has various wings. So some of the major wings include Rupankar, which is the museum of fine arts, Rang Mandal, which is a theater repository, Vagrath, which is a center of Indian poetry, Anhad, which is a kind of library for the classical and folk music, Chavi, which is known for the classical cinema, and Nirala Sri Janpath, which is a chair for creative writing. Now these appear something that is you need to learn and revise, because if you have a question that's being put up on Bharat Bhavan, this is something that you must know and must mention of. The Calico Museum of Textiles is in Ahmedabad. and this is known because it houses some of the rare textiles and fabrics from different parts of the world. The idea was given by Ananda Koraswamy, however later on implemented by Sarabhai Foundation, and who finally established the Calico Museum. The Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaja Vastu Sangrahalaya, it was previously known as Prince of Wales Museum of Western India. So if you have Prince of Wales Museum or Chhatrapati Shivaji, it's one and the same thing. It was named after King George V. It's one of the major historical museums of India, lies at the tip of Crescent site in Bombay. The building is of the Indo-Saracenic style, that's very very important. It's a kind of grade 1 heritage building, provides awareness on the various issues. You have excellent collection of Gandhara School of Art, the miniature paintings, the terracotta paintings from the Gupta period and the Mauryan period. The next is Dr. Bahudaji Rad Museum in Mumbai city. So you have the Mumbai City Museum, which is run by the Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai, Jamnalal Bajaj Foundation and Intact, established in 1872 under the erstwhile Victoria or Albert Museum of Bombay. And later on, this became a separate museum. In 2005, it won the award for excellence. It's known for the various decorative arts it houses. The next is Mehrangarh Museum Trust. Mehrangarh Museum Trust lies in the Mehrangarh Fort region, established in 1972 by Maharaja Gaj Singh. So this is one of the major forts in Rajasthan in Jodhpur. And you have the art and architecture and the historical culture of central Rajasthan, mainly Marwad and Jodhpur, which was being ruled by Rathods during that time, that has been preserved. So you have various collections from there, and it received the UNESCO Asia Pacific Award. The next is Indian Museum. Now you have few of the major museums and libraries that lie in Kolkata, so that's very very important. So National Museum the Indian Museum founded in 1814 by the Asiatic Society. It lies in Kolkata. It's one of the oldest and the largest institutions of its kind. It has two specific galleries, one for mineralogy where you have the various minerals, and the next is numismatic gallery, that's for the Panchmark coins, and you have the various collections of coins, the gold coins, the coins from the Arabic period and the Greek period, which are being conserved here. The next is Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya, which is known as National Museum of Man. It's an anthropological museum located in Bhopal. It's a kind of autonomous organization established under Department of Culture. It has one of the regional centers in Mysore, and you have nearly 36 prehistoric rock shelters which are part of this museum. The next is Mathura Museum, also known as Mathura Sangrahalaya, one of the oldest museums in India. The idea was established by F.S. Godse, and you have nearly 33,000 plus art objects which are part of it, and it includes the Gandhara School of Art. The next is National Council of Science Museum. Now this museum is unique because it houses more than 26 science museums across India. The first one of it was Birla Museum in Calcutta. The second was Vishveshwarya Museum in Bangalore, and the third was in Bombay. It organizes various interactive programs on sciences, and it is again an autonomous institute under Department of Culture. The next is National Museum of India, located in New Delhi, established in 1949. It was under the blueprint of Gaivalkar Committee, established in 1946. So you have, as of present, you have 26 galleries which are there, and in 1960 it was shifted to the new location where it presently is and was made public. It has more than 48,000 collection of books. The next is National Museum Institute of History of Art, Conservation and Museology. This occurs on the first floor of the National Museum that we have discussed, and it was established in 1983. It was converted into a deemed university in 1989. It has various teaching aids and software programs which are mainly for the study on museumology and Indian art and culture. The next is Salarganj Museum, again very very important, located in Hyderabad on the banks of Musi River. It's one of the largest museums of the world. It is again declared as an institute of national importance. It was established by Nawab Mir Yusuf Ali, who mainly acquired the collections from throughout the world. And the most interesting thing is the British bracket clock, where you have a kind of mechanical device with a clock, with a small toy man who comes out and pops the hour and as many times a day. So if it's 12 o'clock, it would ping on 12 times. If it's 2 o'clock, it would ping on 2 times and so on. So it's a kind of really an interesting feature that could be seen here. The next is Raja Ram Mohan Roy Library Foundations. Now moving on from museums to major libraries in India, the first one that we would be talking about is the Raja Ram Mohan Roy Library Foundation, established in 72 on the 200th birth anniversary of Raja Ram Mohan Roy. It's registered under the West Bengal Society Registration Act and it is now declared as a public library open to all. It is fully financed and fully financed by the Ministry of Culture. It's an autonomous organization and it is kind of part of the public library movement that started pre-independence to help initiate the kind of awareness about the major social leaders of India. The next is Rampur Raza Library. It is housed in Hamid Manzil in the fort of Rampur. It's again under the Department of Culture. It has nearly 51,000 printed books and 15,000 manuscripts that are part of it. It's one of the major centers for Indo-Islamic learning and was founded by Nawab Faizaullah Khan in 1774. Delhi Public Library, established in 1951, has 35 branches and more than 18 lakh collection of books. There are two basic units. One is the Braille unit for visually impaired. The other is prison library for Tihar prisoners. It offers free internet and DVD media collection. It has a book stock of more than 12 lakh at present. The next is Library of Tibetan Work and Archive. This is located in Dharamshala in Himachal Pradesh, founded by Tenzin Gyatso. Most of the Tibetan books, Tibetan arts, Tibetan language and the Thangka painting are seen here. There are more than 600 Thangka paintings which are unique to Tibet that are housed here. The National Library, which lies in Kolkata, is the biggest library in terms of volume. It's the India's library of public record that comes under the Department of Culture. It's also unique because under the Delivery of Books Act 1954, this National Library is home to each and every copy published by any of the publications throughout India. It's a repository of UN publications and it renders a kind of many services. And this is some of the statistics that you must know about this library. So, and based on this, we can say it's the largest library by volume. So, this is again very important. The next is Central Reference Library, again in Kolkata. Now, Kolkata was the kind of hub of educational centers pre-independence, and as a result, most of the major libraries and museums that came up housed in the West Bengal area. So you have established in 1955 under the Department of Culture, lies in Calcutta. It compiles and sells the Indian National Bibliography. That's the most important role of the Central Reference Library. This bibliography is being published since 1964. It also houses the Index Indiana. That's the tracing the various periodical literatures that appear in the Indian languages. So you have the various programs that are also run by the Central Reference Library. TMSSM Library, that's the Thanjavur Maharaj Sarfarosi Saraswati Mahal Library, lies in Thanjavur. It's one of the few libraries of the medieval period and is known as the medieval library. You have the information on the various dynasties of Nayak and the Marathas of Thanjavur. In 1918, it became a public library and now has manuscripts in Sanskrit, Marathi, Telugu, Tamil and other languages. There are nearly more than 35 volumes of descriptive catalog that are seen here, and Thanjavur School of Paintings can be seen here. The Central Secretariat Library, again, this was established originally in Calcutta in 1891. Later on, it was shifted to Delhi in 1969. It has nearly 8 lakh volumes and has one of the wings, which is the regional wing in Hindi language, which is known as Tulsi Sadan, and has some of the modern gadgets and reprographic facilities. The next is Khuda Bakhsh Oriental Public Library, established in 1851. In 1969 it was declared as the Institute of National Importance. It's again an autonomous organization under Ministry of Culture. More than 20,000 manuscripts can be seen in Arabic, Persian and Urdu. So it's considered as one of the world's richest Islamic heritage learning center, and it designed the Manuscript Conservation Center under the National Manuscript Mission for Manuscripts. Now we would be covering major cultural missions and schemes in a separate lecture. So we would talk more about the National Mission for Manuscripts there. The next is National Archives of India. It's the oldest institution which is being run by the British India. Now the idea was given by Sandeman, who was a British civil auditor. It was in 1891 known as the Imperial Record Department in Calcutta, which was headed by Forrest. Then later on it was renamed as the National Archives of India and was open to public. It is among one of the new buildings that has been made, and it has been shifted there, and this building was designed by Edwin Lutyens. It has one of the regional offices at Bhopal and three record centers, one at Bhubaneswar, Odisha, Jaipur, Rajasthan and Pondicherry. Then you have in 1940 the Conservation Research Laboratory became the part of this center. So some of the major works of this library includes the National Archives of India include the scientific management, creating close relations between the archivist and the archival institutions, and developing some of more professionalism. Now many of the students have requested for sample questions towards the end of the classes that we are focusing for specifically for UPSC. So here we have three of the sample questions that you can write and evaluate based on what we have studied. So what we have studied and what you would be reading for specifically for Indian heritage and culture would give you a good outline, but when it comes to answer writing, it's very very important that you have a kind of framework of the content and the application of that content into the real world or the present day scenario. So that application part is missing in most of the answers when I am evaluating those. So most of the answers that come in are based on the static information, and those really are not scoring. So make sure you have a kind of very good practice for answer writing, and here you have some of the questions which you can take down, and these would be available below the video as well. So you can take down these questions and practice on your own. Have a good day ahead.